from the Temple of Silence in southern Finland. This is Michael Robbins, and I'm continuing our broadcasts for the Ask program that Tuija and I have been presenting these months whenever we can. The idea behind it: ask and you shall receive, knock and it shall be opened unto you, seek and you shall find. Got those letters mixed up, ASK, ask, seek and knock. In the ancient mysteries, one always had to knock at the portal of initiation. And these days are no different. We have to make our invocative request. Now today we're working on the destiny of the nations, some little continued reading concerning that. And also, you know, there have been terrible circumstances going on in Syria and Iraq. It's a very dangerous situation that involves the potential confrontation of the superpowers as well as the tremendous suffering of the people involved. These humanitarian issues go beyond ideology. We may agree or disagree with the various ideologies which are seeking supremacy through acts of war, but the humanitarian suffering must be relieved. So we can work inwardly, subjectively, in order to help alleviate these desperate situations. We can only imagine what it would be like if any of us were in such circumstances instead of in the safe countries, the so-called safe countries, as so many of us are. So we will begin our work with some readings from this wonderful book, The Destiny of the Nations. I think this book was designed to assist those who were going to, or who will eventually work in the fifth seed group, the group of political workers, political organizers, in which a lot of the first ray could be found. So here is the short text that we'll be working on at the moment. And then we'll have a meditation which will focus on the alleviation of the suffering of the people involved. They really can't do anything about it. They are in a situation which is being mercilessly bombed, attacked. We human beings, we have to solve our problems through the harmonization of our points of view. And as Libra grows stronger in the planetary horoscope, which we are told it will and is now growing stronger in this transition period between Pisces and Aquarius. And as the harmony aspect of the fourth ray comes into right effect, then perhaps we will reach that era of peace which is projected in some of the world scriptures, and which will lead to the unfoldment of the human race in the Aquarian Age. So reading a little here, we're contrasting sixth and seventh ray methods. The seventh ray, the ray of magic, magical order, ceremonial magic, and the sixth ray, the ray of devotion and idealism. In considering the methods whereby the seventh ray purposes are achieved, and of course they must be achieved in the coming 2,500 years and even 25,000 years, perhaps a greater age of Aquarius. I would like to point out, he says, that it is in this part of our discussion that I am limited and handicapped by language, because we are dealing with that which is new. And even though this was written, 70 years ago, it's still very new to us, and therefore not as yet to be truly comprehended, maybe comprehended in part. And we're dealing with those developments which will eventually be brought about by a true and scientific magic. Let us remember how the master Rakosi, now the Maha Chohan, with his seventh ray soul, when he was Francis Bacon, brought in the age of science, inspired the age of science. So he was also working on the fifth ray. And we know that in the Maha Chohan's department, the third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh rays are all involved. The ray of aspect, the third ray, and the four rays of attribute, which include the fifth ray of science. So, magic, the magic of the coming centuries, will be a scientific magic, and the true magician will be trained in the scientific aspects of his art. And notice how science and art must go together, because with art we have the intuitive application of the knowledge of the fifth ray. This new magic, says the Tibetan, will have no more relation to the crude attempts and often ridiculous undertakings of the magicians, alchemists, and performers. Notice he uses that word for its spectacular effect, implying a certain degree of insincerity. The magicians, alchemists, and performers of the past, then, the letter C, A, T, cap, have to an algebraical formula. So, just as he promises the new Renaissance coming, in which the great cathedrals will look like children's building blocks. Imagine that. And I wonder about our symphonies and other great works of art, how childish they will look compared to what we will be able to do. So the magic of the past is very simple compared with the true scientific magic, which is now in process of evolving and will evolve in the age of Aquarius under the fifth ray, which Aquarius transmits, and under the seventh ray cycle, which is coinciding with the processional age of Aquarius. I would remind you also, he says, that in that home of ancient magic, which you call Egypt, I wonder what they, the masters, call it, the magical work there performed was definitely concentrated upon the producing of physical effects and material results. You know, sometimes the preservation of the physical body, as in mummification, and certainly the preservation of the etheric body, where normally it would dissipate. So So there was a certain materialization under the first, fourth, and seventh rays. Vulcan, you know, can be a very material planet and seems to have been involved with those particular rays 1, 4, and 7. So physical effects were the objective, material results, and the focus of the attention of the magician can be seen in the stupendous production of those ancient and gigantic forms, standing silent and still in their pristine magnificence, which they called for the attention of archaeologists and travelers. Well, he's clearly speaking about the pyramids and the temple structures, and we have often wondered how they possibly could have been built given what we think the technology of the early days may have been, and you know, Blavatsky says not 4 or 5,000 years ago, but 60 or 70,000 years ago or more was the time of this building. So a magical process was definitely involved here, with levitation, the ability through sound to bring the building constituents into the proper relationship. We'll rediscover all of this when we're ready for it, and we'll not abuse it. The forms of lesser magic which they produced in Egypt were dedicated to the magical protection of the physical form and allied matters. We human beings, we do seem to have quite an obsession with physicality, which is found in the dense physical vehicle of our planetary logos and of our solar logos, and really in what we call unprincipled matter. Matter inherited from the previous major solar system and which must be redeemed. So we're working in the 18 lower subplanets, we're working in those worlds. And they are stultifying worlds in which true livingness is not easily found. The livingness is found on the cosmic ethers and beyond, but we have to work our way there through spiritual attainment. In latter days, we have the appearance of alchemy in its many forms, plus its search for the philosopher's stone and the teaching as to the three basic mineral elements. Well, we're talking perhaps about practical alchemy and also philosophical alchemy, as was the intellectual property of some of those who actually practiced the art with greater understanding. The mineral elements, well, there's certainly three mineral states, the solid, liquid, and gas, and maybe we can think of the earthen states, the metallic states, and finally, the states of jewels, gems, those formations. So whatever he means here about the three mineral elements, there are different perspectives here. These alchemists, they were esoterically driven, and from the subjective side of life, to search for that which could unify the three lower physical levels. Well, that was for them, the gaseous, the liquid, and the dense physical. But when we think about the three lower physical levels, we think about the mental plane, the emotional plane, lower mental plane, emotional plane, and the etheric physical plane. So this unification, says the Tibetan, is in its nature deeply symbolic of racial unfoldment, because obviously there were attempts here at what we call the integration process, in which true students of psychology are now involved, attempting to integrate the personality under the impression of our higher self or soul. These levels symbolize the integrated man, physical, astral, and mental. The gaseous is the mental, the fluid is the astral, and the dense physical, of course, the physical area. When to these elements the philosopher's stone is added, you know, and what can this be? Perhaps we can consider this the so-called jewel in the lotus at the heart of the causal body, at the heart of the egoic lotus that that of the Philosopher's Stone, and that has done its magical work, as the soul ever does, because the soul is the source of the true white magic, then you have the symbolic representation of the control by the soul of the four higher levels of the physical plane, the etheric, or energy levels. And that really is what we have to learn to control. Our attention to the dense physical, those days are somewhat past, and we have to learn how to, in the Aquarian age, the etheric age, we might say, control all physical matters from the etheric levels. Of this desirable consummation, the Philosopher's Stone is the emblem. I said emblem, I did not say symbol. Here he differentiates. A symbol is an outer and visible sign of an inner and spiritual reality, carried out into expression upon the physical plane by the force of the inner embodied life. So a symbol has a very intimate relationship with the reality which it represents. An emblem is less than that. It's man's formulation or concept, created by man and embodying for him the truth as he sees it and understands it. But a symbol is ever greater in its implications than an emblem. Somehow a symbol really embodies the nature of the inner reality and is not just a sign indicating that reality. The etheric levels are also the field of expression for the soul. The etheric levels, we know, are principled, that they relate to our present solar system, and they are not like the dense physical matter inherited from the previous solar system, and not principled with respect to the seven principles of our present solar system. So we have to change their configuration so that they can rightly adapt to the principles of our present love, wisdom, solar system. So the etheric levels are also the field of expression for the soul, especially in the coming age, whether it's the human soul or the soul as an expression of a higher triad. That is really the true soul. The true ego is the higher triad, and if we go even further, our true identity is the monadic life. We're on our way, and perhaps during the age of Aquarius, we will discover this. I wonder whether any of you have the faintest idea of what will happen to humanity when the inner subjective reality, that which we more essentially are, functioning through the etheric and pouring its forces unimpeded through the etheric centers in that body, will have made its major controlling integration with the dense physical apparatus. You know, a kind of initiation exists when, and it did exist in ancient days, when ancient man tried to link his etheric nature and his physical nature. An initiate in those days could do that. And even today, we have deviation from the intention, the principled intention pouring through the etheric body. We have a physical deviation from those intentions. And many of us from time to time are subject to those deviations. So we have to have this this major controlling integration through the etheric body with the dense physical apparatus, reducing it to complete submission as a result of the higher integration consummated between the soul and personality. The dense physical apparatus cannot run the show, and it is the sign of the initiation of humanity that finally it will be controlled according to the higher principles. You know, the first initiation is very physical, etheric in its nature, and humanity is preparing for that and the reappearance of the great Lord Maitreya, the head of the spiritual hierarchy, will indicate that the first initiation of humanity, at least humanity in its higher brackets, so to speak, will have occurred. So exactly when that is, we don't know, but we're on our way to that. The timing question is very much in our hands, and it depends on how we work individually and how we work in a broader social context. We are therefore at a most interesting and crucial period in racial and planetary history. By racial, he means the entire human race. has preceded it, and for the reason that the evolutionary process has been definitely successful in spite of all failures, mistakes, and delays. We're allowed to see things from a very close range, rather myopically, and as a result, think that we are involved in catastrophic failures, mistakes, and delays, when in fact, overall, over the centuries, over the eons, the evolutionary progress intended by hierarchy for humanity has actually been occurring, and at a fairly rapid rate, as we have much ground to make up due to ancient failures, we're told, on the moon chain. So these delays, of these latter, there have been many, owing to the refusal, now this is very interesting, owing to the refusal, curious and difficult to understand in your eyes, of the energies, capital E, concentrated at Shambhala, you know, the so-called lights which carry out the will of God in Shambhala. And there's been a hesitancy to impose the force of will on matter and on form until such time as this can be done with the cooperation of the human family. Much imposition could occur, and the first ray, which is characteristic of Shambhala, is the ray of imposition, but when there is simply imposition without understanding, without cooperation, actually in the long run time is lost because humanity doesn't learn much. It doesn't come to its own realizations about the necessity of cooperating with that which is imposed, and it simply reverts to its old methods, and we have to start all over again. So anyway, this attitude of Shambhala towards humanity, the frequent Shambhala impacts we've been having 1825, 1975, year 2000, and maybe something, who knows, in 2025, and during the war period from 1914-45, there have been hints that the Shambhala influence was strongly operative then. There's been quite a concentration of Shambhalic attention to humanity and to our dense physical plan in general. Anyway, all this has never been possible hitherto. You know, there was a great Shambhala impact in Atlantis. It caused the sinking of large parts of that very extensive continent, of which we're told the USA was the center. And then in Lemuria, the volcanic destruction of Lemuria, that was a shambolically inspired event, but they were events few and far between, and now just in the last 200 years we've had a number of these impacts, so things are heating up. This has never been possible hitherto owing to the unpreparedness of man for the task of cooperating, and his ignorance as to the plan, which is why our educational process informing intelligent humanity of the divine plan and what it essentially means in terms of the seven ashrams, why that is so very, very important, and why we who are involved in the educational effort have to really spread the word so people can have a wider point of view, and so the ignorance in which humanity habitually walks can be lifted. The Lord of Shambhala, Sanat Kumara, and his helpers have had to wait until at least the dim outlines of the plan had penetrated through into the consciousness of the race. Well, that's just beginning to happen now, and we see the larger context in which we are working, and the fact that from hierarchy, and impressed upon humanity by hierarchy, is a divine plan, which is their response to the divine purpose of the Lord of Shambhala. So this is beginning to happen, and with increasing frequency, and from day to day, more and more intelligent men and women are coming or are being brought into touch with the emerging ideas of the hierarchy. The realm of ideas, we know, is found within the cosmic ethers, which is now, ever since 1925 or so, the focus of the majority of ashrams within the hierarchy. We can look, therefore, for the steady appearance, gradually and cautiously applied, very cautiously applied, as it is so destructive, if incautiously applied, the steady appearance of the will energy of the highest center, Shambhala, which is to be found upon our planet. This center corresponds to the monadic center in man, which makes its power felt in the consciousness of the disciple who is ready for the third initiation. More and more people will be ready, and during the age of Aquarius, and especially during the impending age of Capricorn, maybe 2300 years from now. It's a time when the third initiation will flourish, as Capricorn is particularly the sign of the zodiac associated with this great expansion of consciousness, which truly makes of the disciple an initiate. But much of the second initiation will be taken during the age of Aquarius. Once the second initiation has been taken, the watching hierarchy can begin to note the constant reorientation of the soul towards the monad, and the attractive power of that highest aspect of the initiate. And perhaps a number of us find ourselves in that position, more and more interested in being, more and more interested in the spirit aspect, the highest aspect of our nature, and more able to see the oneness of things and not be misled by hateful and separative glamours and illusions. Today, so many members of the human family, he says, in incarnation or out of incarnation, have taken the first two initiations of the threshold, initiations of the threshold, that the attention of Shambhala is being increasingly turned to humanity via the hierarchy. You know, it's a safeguard. Otherwise, it's a direct Shambhala impact, and that can be very drastic, as happens from time to time. While simultaneously the thoughts of men are being turned to the plan, what's really trying to happen through humanity in the various kingdoms, divinely guided, to the use of the will in direction and guidance, and to the nature of dynamic force. We're learning something about the will, though Master DK insists that we really know very little about what the true will is. The quality, for instance, of the explosive and dynamic nature of war in this century is indicative of this. For the will energy is one of its aspects. For the will energy in one of its aspects is an expression of death and destruction, largely the third aspect of the will energy. The first ray is the ray of the destroyer, but not wanton destruction for bad motives, but ultimately destruction so that the divine plan can actually manifest through the things, through the situations which were previously blocked by certain forms which had to go. What can therefore be seen occurring is the effect of the Shambhala force, and that's, you know, the war, what can be seen occurring in war, the effect of the Shambhala force upon the forms in nature due to the misuse of the incoming energy by man. We could use this energy to promote the peace, and we will. But now he distinguishes between the different types of war and tells us that our motives for war, although the war is not desirable, in most cases, our motives have risen. War in the past, speaking generally and esoterically, has been based consistently upon the attractive power of possession. And this has led to the aggressive and grasping character of the motives which have led to war. Acquisitive, in some sense, Orion, in some sense, involving the desire body and the satisfaction of lower desires, very Martian in a certain sense. But gradually there has been a change coming about, and war has lately been founded upon somewhat higher motives and the acquisition of more land and territorial possessions has not been the true and main motive. I guess, well, you know, if you look at World War II and Germany's apparent desire for Lebensraum, you know, more room in which to live for the master race, so-called. But behind it all was an ideology, terrible ideology, hateful ideology, but excuse me, it was an ideology nonetheless, and the desire was to impose that ideology upon humanity. So it was simply not for material possessions that the war was being fought, although that was an ingredient. War has been prompted by economic necessity, interesting, or it has been in the nature of the imposition of the will of some nation or group of nations, and their desire to impose some ideology or upon some ideology or other upon some nation, or maybe a higher motive, to rid itself of a worn-out system of thought, of governments, of religious dogma. Usually we call these things revolutions, rebellions, which is holding back racial development, you know. When the people have enough and they rebel because the will is ever a foundational principle in all human beings. The human race has a lot of the first ray in it and proceeds to evolve through the power of destruction, which is quite different from the way the Vedic kingdom evolves. So this is being now consciously done, this rebellion, and is an expression of the Shambhala will force, and is not so definitely the desire force of the past. Well, when we begin to look at the terrible situations in the Middle East at the present time, you know that triangle of evil that D.K. talked about, he wasn't too specific, I suppose, on purpose, but there was this triangle that had its one angle in the United States, especially with the imposition of Zionism. Instead of the distribution of the Jewish group over the world, which was the desirable hierarchical intention, there was this reassertion of the quest for Zion. Then the Middle East as a whole right now, no longer a holy land, he says, no longer a holy land, but a place where much evil is working out, and we can see the danger to humanity concerning this situation, which could lead to the Third World War, which cannot be fought. There's also a place in Central Europe. He doesn't specify it, I suppose purposefully. He avoids specification. We're not sure what it could be and in what country it may be found. There are different speculations, but this is the triangle of evil. And he tells us that it is pretty much energized by six leaders in the East, very, very powerful, and six leaders in the West, less powerful, but that those are the representatives of the Black Lodge who are promoting the toward form, a movement towards a re-embodiment of form and re-initiation into the earth. As we work with the triangles, using the great invocation and triangulating the etheric body of our planet in groups of threes, you know, how we form that with two other individuals and use the great invocation, we are making possible the coming of the redemptive energies which can help ward off the predations of the Black Lodge, the forces of evil on our planet. They are still quite active. They will be defeated, and we know they will be banished, and by the Judgment Day, it's still a long time, but by the Judgment Day, they will be completely banished from our planet. We're working with the Lord Christ, by whatever name you want to call him, even in the Islamic faith, the Imam Mahdi, as it is called, is thought to be really a representation of the Lord Maitreya, and that would certainly synthesize the various religions if this could be realized as true. But basically, we are gathering as we do our work in the name of the head of the spiritual hierarchy of our planet, the Lord of Love, seats of the United Nations, excuse me, and also eventually through Darjeeling, where the pure first ray force will be working. And this is a picture here of those planetary centers. Well, we, wherever we may be in the world, we draw our inspiration from one of them. Their number will increase, of course, as the root races go onward. Right now we're in the fifth root race, and there are five. So our meditative work really is about the struggle that is going on in the Middle East, and especially concentrated in Iraq and Syria at this time. It seems all prophesied, you know, because there are certain explanations of this period which tell us that the Armageddon, you know, the final war, occurs within Syria, and things are shaping up for that. And yet this is a war which must not precipitate out of the physical plane. According to Master DK, it must be fought out psychologically. It must be fought out on the plane of mind between the different ideologies. So in this difficult transition period, we human beings often resort simply to force. And might is seen as making right, and the people who are not in power, they're caught in the middle and they suffer a great deal, as we've seen recently, as a major city in Syria is being, you know, bombed into rubble. Whether it's, in this case, it's the administration of Assad and the Soviet or the Russian backers, but all the major powers are involved somehow in this Middle East situation. So we know that Lord Maitreya is a reality, and the hierarchy is a reality, and the way of love is a divine and necessary possibility. So we think about, particularly at this time, Aleppo, and the kind of drastic suffering that is going on there. Everyone, the residents, are being killed, being buried under the rubble. Children are being killed. Whatever the karmic factors may be, you know, we don't justify any of that on the basis of karma. things have to be worked out in negotiation. And we think of also the love, from the point of love, within the heart of God, and really that's, in one sense, that's from the hierarchy, that love stream forth into the hearts of men. I know it seems remote. We have people just blasting each other to smithereens. But let love stream forth into the hearts of men. May the Christ, the Lord Maitreya, the head of hierarchy, may he return to earth. Spend a few moments of silence visualizing the effect of love flowing into these, love and wisdom flowing into these desperate situations. And that relief. Savior, the Christ, as he's called in some traditions. That energy must pervade all situations and bring relief to the drastic, destructive situations to which so many are presently submitted. So let us be animated at this Libra time, with the full moon coming, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning, GMT on Sunday morning, we're having our full moon broadcast to you. We'll be leading that exact, including the exact moment of the full moon at 4:23 and 2 seconds Greenwich Mean Time. The flags of the nations, not all of them are seen here, but they all represent high ideals, and they can all be in harmony with each other. The Great Invocation is our mantra. It's a great shambolic invocation for light and power, and it will bring, if properly used by enough people in the many different languages, it will bring the externalization of the hierarchy closer, and also the reappearance of the world of peace. We have our broadcast at 3 a.m. tomorrow morning, Sunday morning, GMT. Full moon is about an hour and a half later. It's a very, very important sign, so we hope that if you don't have your own full moon activities, you can join us. And then also we'll be working following that broadcast. We'll do the attraction of money for hierarchical purposes. So, you know, we got that little meditation may occur a little bit later than usual because of the full moon work, but if you just stay tuned in on the broadcasting channel, you'll be able to receive that. So let us intensify our point of attention during the coming day and try to achieve that quietude of a true contemplative realization of the harmony and the peace which must emerge through deeper understanding, through perfect poise, a completed point of view, and divine understanding. These are the requirements for harmlessness, and when Libra finally comes into effect, and it's growing more powerful than the planetary horoscope all the time, we are told, there will be love, wisdom, and divine understanding, a completed point of view, poise, there will be harmlessness. Right now we hardly understand it, but the growth of Libra will assist us. Sunday morning.